So we can go here to SGD. Stochastic gradient descent folder. You are already on the. Everybody has the exercises on the on Dynt.
For the web page, maybe the event page.
So you have to go come here. What's up? CSS. Events, upcoming events. What?
Yeah, past.
I don't know. Past. Okay. Past events. Overview. And everything is. So the exercises are here and on GitHub. You can go to Dynt and. So if you click here, everybody has the code already? Okay, then it's fine. Okay, so you put it in your home folder, open, so find it here on the Jupyter, and so it's TensorFlow training CSCS test. Well, test for me, but not for you, but anyway. SGD, okay, and open. So this is only one notebook there. Okay, everybody's here in the same page? Literally. Okay, I would like to move a bit, otherwise I cannot see. So this one, we're going to generate images, generate random data from NumPy. It looks like this, it's linear, and we're going to use the same model we talk about. So, a linear model, and also you can see in a real example, what I showed before yesterday, with the how to plug the pipeline to a simple model, very simple, and then you will do a training of this model on this linear data. And the idea is that, so you will see the convergency, you will see the fit, and the idea is you can work with this plot here and get something like I showed before with the with different batch sizes and moving from gradient descent to stochastic gradient descent to mini batch gradient descent, change the size of the mini batch, of course. You already know that all this is decided here on the input pipeline. There are a maximum of 100,000 workers, and yeah. So please, now I will give you 15 minutes, 10 minutes, and just try different configurations and understand the algorithm. If you have questions, we can go to the computers. And I think we can make a break here, no? On the recording. Open this one, the one that has exercise. You will see that we import Horobot. We do Horobot init, but we don't do anything else. So this script is wrong. It's not well done. So your task now is to adapt it to Horobot, no? So I did the first two steps, so these two, and then you adapt it. You remember the steps you have to do to adapt some regular code to Horobot. And one thing is, so now we are going to run it on SSH. We are not going to run it here on the notebook because now we have one node. And we need to do this run operation, so this run command to duplicate the workers. I'm just showing it here. And one thing is, let me just go to the This one is at the end of the presentation. You can find it. So it's this one here. One thing is we are the idea is we're going to run a script. It's going to create some data, and we're going afterwards to plot that data. No, so to plot we don't need this run. So the idea is you have to log like this to Ella with the -6. Otherwise, it will tell you, okay, I cannot open this window. And to dynt as well as this with -x, and then inside you go to the sgd folder, and you can do an allocation and work inside of this allocation. Don't do more than one, please, because it's two nodes per person. So you do one allocation and you work in your terminal. So this one is going to use TensorFlow and two nodes. You load Horobot. This is, remember, you did that before on your Jupyter hoop-env file to have access on Jupyter. So, and then you run it like this. It's run Python exercise, and then it will create some files, and you can plot it like this. Python maybe can be a bit slow because I don't know. I tried at home with Ella. And it was a bit slow, but here I don't know. Maybe it's fast, maybe it's slow. Anyway, you can have you should have patience. And the thing is, every step you can try different combination of leaving things undone and done. For instance, not doing the initialization. And doing the wrapping of the optimizer, and you can see what happens, and you can have a good feel of what is behind of every step you do to adapt code to Horobot. So you will get a window similar to the other one. If you don't get any, you get just the surface and no trajectory. Maybe it's that they are a bit far. Maybe you can go and put a higher, so a larger range on the plot. Or otherwise, run it several times, you will see it. And yes, so you can, if you want, you can keep working until I don't know 25 and on the initial notebook on Jupyter, or otherwise you can start using this one. Anyway, after launch, we will start working with this one. So I'm going to open the solution directly. Is it find the font right?
Yeah.
The size is nice. So it's simple, no? Oops. No, it's not. It's Horobot simple. So we'll discuss more or less the main questions you were asking. So first, so this is the whole thing already done. So this one was already done. It's the first step, Horobot init to initialize the Horobot environment or the communication environment. This if you do MPI, you have to do also that. Always that you have, need communication in general, you need first to do some initialization step. So now here, as you saw, we generate the data and we create a pipeline. So the first thing before going to Horobot is something that he was pointing out. It's nice to see. So we have also a comment here that it's a bit of a, it's my hand. Here, when we do this operation here, so x and y that are going to go to our model, this line here is what shows the integration of the pipeline and the model as a just one thing. So if you picture it, a graph of operation, and the pipeline should be the two things connected. The pipeline that in some point is connected to a graph. And now in your session, anytime you run the training operation, you will fetch things from the data set objects, from the pipeline. So the thing is, So you create the model, you select your loss. This loss has y and y hat. So anytime you call loss and you run loss, you will be running the whole graph and by extensions the pipeline. And anytime you ask for loss, you will be fetching a value from here. And anytime you fetch a value from here, the iterator is going to advance, and you're losing data. Okay, you are advancing the pipeline. Okay, and this one is something a bit external to the graph, which is something that you pass the loss, no, and it will take care of doing the minimization of the loss. What is the microphone?
Learning rate for the number of ranks or not?
Yes, that is something that you have to test, right? So there is this intuition, empirical thing that I showed before. So I saw equations, but the analysis was not really something analytical. It was just guessing, more or less, having a feel of the sizes of the updates. No, how you can. Take advantage of the largest update size that you can do. But this is something that you have to try. Maybe for your case it's going to fail, maybe it's just to diverge, and maybe it's just going to, like for them, to go from 1 week of training to 1 hour. Okay? Something you have to try. Okay, good point. Also, the distributed operation is going to run the whole graph, but not only is going to call it, it's just to do the complete minimization. No? If you run says run loss, you are going to run the loss. You're going to evaluate your graph and, of course, affect the pipeline. But if you run train is an operation, you are going to run the whole thing, the stochastic gradient descent algorithm. Okay, the first thing that was missing... Eh? Okay. The first thing that was missing was that the hooks no were there, so the line was not there. But then when you try to put it, you see that here there is a session. And if you try to put directly the hook into session, maybe you got an error. I don't know if somebody got an error. But maybe you got an error, or you should have got an error. And then you realize that you have to use monitor training session. So you realize not, you check in the solution, and you realize that you have to use this one. And this one, so is here commented. After the session, there was another step that most of you had problem. What was with the initialization of the parameter? So this dealing with this part, there was a says room init. Here you see in the solution that there is not init defined, and this is because. So it's here written, the monitor training session will take care of that for you. So even if you don't do HoroBot, you don't need to use the init. And then what was happening is that you were, so the training session was doing the initialization, was running the hook, which the hook is a function that is going to, as we discussed in the morning, is going to broadcast the values to the rest of the workers, to the parameters of the rank 0 to the rest of the ranks. Sorry, and then if you have a says init, you're going to again do initialization. So you're going to run that first line in the shell again, and then you're going to override the fact that HoroBot did the synchronization of the workers. Okay. So this is some important point. Now this is pretty much the same. And sorry, there was something before. The other thing is that it was missing this, no? The train operation was not wrapped by the HoroBot optimizer. So what you were doing, so if you run it like this, you are running two distinct ranks. They are completely unconnected and, sorry, disconnected, and they have nothing to do with that. One with each other. So if you do this, now you are telling robot that after each step is going to do the synchronization. So the synchronization means, okay, we wait that all the ranks did the back propagation, so calculated the gradients, and I'm going to do the average, and I'm going to do the update with this average, okay? And that was it. So that, I think, was most of the problems you had. Also, he pointed out as well that he was looking at the output of the log of Slurm, that he tells you how much energy do you use and how much CPU do you use, GPU. And he was saying, so this job didn't use GPU. And he was pointing out that changing the batch size from 1,000 gradient descent to 500, with this case 500 doing stochastic gradient descent mini batch, it was using the GPU, and with the other one it wasn't using it. So that can be some optimization that the TensorFlow had inside, or I don't know, or some bug, I don't know. Maybe I would say it's an optimization, but for sure, one problem can be that this is guessing more or less, but one problem can be that here you're not using operations of TensorFlow, you're using normal multiplication and addition. Maybe they are already overloaded with TensorFlow data, but maybe not, and that's something that you can check out. But if you would use something like TF sum or TF multiply, I don't know the name now, and then TF sum, maybe in that case, if this TensorFlow operation has GPU properties, this means that it automatically will recognize it as something that you can do in the GPU and will take it to the GPU, okay? And that can explain why, for his case, it wasn't always using the GPU. And I think this is all. If you have other questions, yes.
I'm confused by the fact that we use, that like not all of the things, all of the changes that we need to do to make it distributed are using the Horovod API. That like the sharding, for example, uses the TensorFlow API and other things use the Horovod. Is there, like, does it have to be that way? Because I'm kind of bothered by the fact that we don't just use only Horovod API to make it distributed.
Okay, as I see it, and I don't know, I like to see the pipeline, so the input pipeline as a one piece of the code, and the model as another piece of the code, and this session thing, the execution of the graph, another piece. And Horovod, as I understand, he acts only on the model. He doesn't act on what is the model receiving. So so you have your independent workers, that this one actually you did with Slurm, not with Horovod. You have all these the workers, and what the workers get, this is not decided by Horovod. This is decided by the input pipeline. This is where you said, okay, I'm going to give this thread of stream of data, I'm going to do it like this. It's not a thing that I think Horovod would take care of. I don't know, my opinion. Is it fine? Okay, so now we can... so the next is... exercise. Now we exit here and we go to sorry, let me just check which order I have. Oh, Keras. Well, actually you can select which one do you want to use. No? Now we are going to use consecutively this one, custom estimator from benchmarks, or models from Keras application. This one are very similar, it's more or less the same thing. In they use CNN models, the same models that we saw before in the benchmark, Inception, the ResNet. They use a different ResNet because in the same implementation was not on both of them, but it doesn't matter. and VGG 16. And now what we want to do here, so this one is more, it's a real network. However, the training is really used to showcase the API and how it works. It's not complicated. It's something that maybe is not going even to converge. But we are interested here in see the steps and see the convergence, the performance. And so we are going to go there. Let's, you can start. It doesn't matter by each one, just take this one. It's the same exercise. You have a Horobot estimator, and you have only estimator. You can adapt this one to this one. And now this one, they use some optimizations on the pipeline. You also can play with that. And you can go to the compute node and do run this command, NVIDIA SMI minus L2. And you will get something like top that is cycling. And you can see the GPU utilization. And then the idea is that you can play a bit with optimization of the pipeline and also adapt to Horobot the exercise. So it's the two things. It's more like a summary of the of yesterday and today. And with that, you can see the effect on the GPU utilization. Okay, you can see that sometimes if you miss, for instance, the things like the prefetch that we discussed yesterday, your GPU utilization may drop a little bit, or I don't know. You can play with that. You can change any parameters. This I don't remember how long this will take. The idea is you run it. It should be fast. You can let it finish, or you run it. You see the NVIDIA SMI output, and when you are satisfied, you kill it. So Control C, you stop it, and then you run it again, and you change the things very interactively. Okay, and so in this one, the steps are on the slide. But the thing is that only in this one, only in the other one, to make it easier, very easy for you, and at the same time to use big models, because if you don't use a big model, you won't see any strong use of the GPU, because it's not necessary. So if we wanted to use something like Inception here, it would take most of the script, and you would get absolutely lost. So I did this script here, get models from benchmark, and in this script we download data from a repository of TensorFlow. We download some of the things, and we create a folder. Actually, I can run it. So you should start like this. Bash get. It will download something, and now you have a model from benchmark. This one wasn't before, and now you go here. And this one also maybe it's nice if you are learning and afterwards when you repeat all these exercises at home, because this downloads from the benchmark repository. The benchmark repository is huge. It has a lot of models, a lot of things, loggers. Optimization, I don't know, it's insane, it's very large. And this one downloads only the things you need to run a simple example. So here we need just this file data set, which if you do a cat, it's only one line, the number of ImageNet image, and this comnet builder, and inside we have the models. And that's it. If you want to add new models to this script, because you want to try them, you can look around on the benchmark repository, and then you can add it here. It requires a bit of work because some models need some things, but in principle it can be easy to do. And now, so you are inside of the folder, you copy what you want. Let's start with Inception, and you run it here from inside of the folder, because it will import things from model, okay? And now, when you see here, We import here from models, inception model. We import this thing. And now we do this. And now we have a model. And it was very, very simple to do. I mean, we didn't have to create a whole, I don't know, 1,000 lines of script to see where to put Horobot. So that's the thing. Remember, you have to run inside of the folder, so the instructions are on the web page. For Keras, there is no problem. You use something that is called Keras applications, that everything is already implemented there. You just load it, and that's it.
Can you just run it and show how to use this profile?
Profiling? I didn't say profiling.
Like this
NVIDIA
profile?
Ah, OK, yes, it's a good. I want to do as a lock, but I am my computer. I'm sorry. I'm a laptop. On my laptop. Scratch. I think I have it here. Model from. Okay. We do one as a lock. I got it fast. We open another window. So you need two windows, one for the SMI and one for the where you're going to run. Control shift. Oh. Okay, it's like this. I said that. So step number one. You come here. It's a bit there are several steps, but you can ask me afterwards. That I didn't do it on the slide, but you can see. So when you are home alone, you can find it in internet how to log in on the node. Okay, it's not particularly hard. So you can use S control. Is the best way, no?
Find the node.
Yes, S control. Show. S control show job, and then you put here the ID of your job. Okay, the location you got. And here is the node. No. Here is the node. Okay? And now you, in your other window, you do like this. I'm already undined. So you do like this. SSH, the name you took, you got. And you are inside of the node now. So here you have an allocation, but you are in the login node. But here now you are in the inside of the login node. On the compute node. That's why I didn't put it on the slides, because just don't do weird things. Just NVIDIA SMI, but if you do something else, you can maybe break something, okay? And you will interrupt for sure your calculation. So you do this, and then you run NVIDIA. I think I should have it in memory. No. NVIDIA SMI minus L2. So this one is going to print something like this. Now I'm not running anything, so it's zero. This is the number you want to see. Here you can see the memory. Okay, so everybody got the command. And now, so we are here. Module load, dynt horobot. And do s run. This is going to crash, I'm pretty sure. I don't remember the allocation, if it was multiple nodes or... So I have only one node, so I'm going to run the non-Horobot thing. Estimator, inception. So I'm going to come here because my neck is killing me. I know it. Ah, of course, I forgot to put Python. I think my neck is not, the blood is not going to my brain anymore. Squeezing too much Python. Okay, so permission denied. I was trying to run a non-executable script, okay? Okay, now, so the thing starts. And now you look to here, you will see some point. This is going to fill all the memory, and the GPU is going to to start being used. This is like NASA when they are waiting for. So if you can clap hands, okay. No, it's happening now. So the memory, you see, is already full. So the TensorFlow, now you can change it not to do that, but I really don't know yet what is the advantage, but maybe for you, for your workflows, it can be an advantage. You can look how to tell TensorFlow not to do that. It's very simple, it's just two lines. So the GPU is still not being used. It's transferring memory. Okay, something started. Okay, yeah, we have 99%. Zero. And now, so now you have to do to play with the input pipeline and also make the script Horovod so Horovod code, no? Because you have the same exercise as before. There is no plot. Now you have millions of parameters. You cannot plot, and you can see now you will see that when you start changing the input pipeline, where you get errors, of course, sometimes. But other times you will get things like this. You get a zero in the middle of the calculations, or sometimes you get a 100% constant. So this is the things you want to do in this exercise. Okay? And also, so it's finishing now. If you want to have, maybe you can use also if you want this option, minus U, that it means that the output is going to come out as it appears, otherwise it is going to be buffered. And maybe you will get the evaluation before the training and it's going to be a bit messy. With minus U should be everything sequentially as TensorFlow prints it. Okay? And then, if you stop the calculation, because you don't want to wait so much, you want to see the GPU usage and the thing, but anyway, it was very fast, you can do Control-C here, but just be patient, because now you are breaking a calculation that is multi-threaded and extremely complex, and it will take time to do it, okay? So in principle, if you want, if it doesn't take too much time, maybe you can wait for it. And these kind of things. So before wrapping up completely this part, I want to make a comment.
One question?
Yes.
What was the command to get the compute node name again?
Wait, I have a better answer for that, so I can take that. So when you do an S alloc, if it's only one node, you're going to see directly. And you can, if it's only one node, you can also do s run hostname. It's much simpler than s run hostname, and you can see which is the node ID.
If you have two nodes with Horovod, you can start doing it with one node if you want. No, if you have two nodes with Horovod, you just do the NVIDIA semi in one of them. Don't need to have two NVIDIA semis and okay. So, and then at the end, just close it and please don't type anything here because it can be a bit dangerous, okay? So I'm going to close. So before, we'll leave this. Should I, will keep the reservation just in case?
Sorry?
I will keep the reservation, this is not stood, but. I want to make a quick comment since now you will start working, then we will stop the recording. So yesterday, just a bit of a summary. Yesterday we saw the input pipelines, and today we saw the distributed learning. And so I hope this is useful for you. And so this, we selected this, as I said before, because it's two important things in HPC. One is the I/O, extremely important, and the other one is the scaling of calculations. We also presented how to build pipelines. So this is not the only thing you can do. So you can write your code, if you are good enough, you can write your code as performant as you want with your own logic. But this is only just a suggestion, and well, a good one, in my opinion. So we also talk about TF record files, that if you want, there is a notebook, you can do it today as well. This is a way to store data that allows you to leverage a lot of good code done already by TensorFlow and by Google with the protocol buffers that saves. So you pay some price writing the file, but you earn a lot afterwards doing the calculations at runtime. And again, this is not so you have to use it. So it's just an option. It's so you know that it exists. And the same with Orobot. So there are many ways to do distributed learning, and this one is just one of them. And always just keep a look on what TensorFlow will bring in the next month. Maybe it's going to be good something else. Maybe it's going to be Orobot. Maybe they're going to incorporate Orobot. I don't know. But okay, these are points that you can take out. And that's it. So now, if you want, you can start working, and you can ask me questions, okay?